myself Ms. Rachna Jain, associate professor, department of English, government PG college, Rajgarh, Alwar. In this video lecture, I am going to explain you the poem The Sea and the Skylark. In the previous video, I have explained you the two stanzas of this poem. Now I will explain you the remaining part of the poem The Sea and the Skylark. This poem is mentioned in the syllabus of BA Part 3rd, English Literature, Paper 1st, Unit A. First of all, I describe you the word meanings of this poem. This shallow and frail town, and how this shame means the sea and the skylark put to shame this town rile with its meaningless, unworthy life which has no vitality in it. In other words, modern urban life is something of which people should feel ashamed by the comparison with the vigorous life of nature. This shallow and frail town means the town of Ryle, where this poem was written. In this described, shallow and frail are terms of the disparagement of the town or urban life as contrasted with the life of nature presented by the sea and the skylark. How ring right and turbid time, these two pure sounds ring out by contrast our sordid, confused and ugly urban civilization. Turbid means confused and disordered. Being pure means the two sounds of the life of nature in general are pure and devoid of any sin. We life's pride and cared for crown. It means we, the human beings, are the pride and crown of all the creation. We are the most cared for beings, that is, cared by God. Now, I again tell you the word meaning of the last stanza. Have you lost that cheer and the charm of earth's past prime? It means we have lost the joy and the glory of the morning of human race. That time of joy and jest is gone because of our sinfulness and the selfishness of our industrial civilization. Our make and making break. The line is a little confusing. The meaning is not very clear. Perhaps Hopkins is referring to the process of decay and deterioration which industrial materialism has started and which is smearing the earth with ugliness. Our make, our mould and the purpose for which we are created are breaking little by little, and man is moving towards his doom. To man's last dust means man is heading towards death. Drain fast towards man's first slime. It was out of dust that man was originally made, and he is moving rapidly towards that dust, that is death. Man is going to an end before he began. Thus man is moving fast to his doom, when he will die and mingle with the dust of which he is made. Thus man is witnessing not progress but retrogression. These lines are from Hopkins' poem entitled The Sea and the Skylark. The poem is a sonnet. The rhyme scheme of the sonnet is a contrast between the life-giving purity of nature and the sordidness of the civilization that man is creating. The poet hears two natural sounds, the sound of the sea waves and the sound of the skylark singing in the air. He feels much impressed by these sounds. Natural beauty is still a living force to him and a constant reassurance of God's concern for the world. In these lines, the poet contrasts the element purity with the shallow and frail town with its sordid, turbid look and atmosphere. The town referred to is Ryle. This town was a summer resort to which English people thronged from May onward. But during the off-season, the town appeared to be a ghost town. The poet says that the two sounds of the sea and the skylark are putting Ryle to shame. The voices emanating from nature rise far above the sordid and confused human sounds. It is so because the voices from the objects of nature are pure. The town is shallow and pale. The human sounds of the town are sordid and confused. The poet says that we human beings are the pride of creation and the crown of that we are all beings in the world. Even God cares for the human beings. Yet we have lost that cheer and charm, the state of joy, because of the sinfulness and selfishness of our industrial civilization. We have lost the state of innocence and happiness which men enjoyed in ancient times. Hopkins' sensitivity to beauty seems to be so delicate that he appears unable to consider industrialization except with overwhelming horror. He never enters into the life of industrial society and finds it wanting. He merely stands at a distance and condemns. In these lines, these are the final lines of the poem. In these lines, the poet Hopkins says that man was created last as life's crown, God's special care, but to the poet, both man as species and his products seem to be crumbled back to dust. The poet says that we are gradually being reduced to the featureless materials out of which we have been made. It was out of dust or slime that man was originally made, and to dust we shall ultimately return. We are losing our constructive energy rapidly and are moving fast to our doom, to our original state of slime. The poet means to say that we human beings are supposed to be the pride of creation and the honored lords of the whole world. However, our condition has now worse need. We have lost all the joy and charm of the earth when all things were in their prime. Now, the static and dynamic aspects of our being are in process of decay and disintegration. This process will lead us to the state of dust which awaits us in death and which recalls man's original state of slime. Our end will thus rejoin our beginning. We shall end as we begin. We are witnessing not progress but depression and retrogression. Hopkins have looks these things at the developing industrial society. He hates them. He does not enter into the life of industrial society and finds it wanting. He merely stands at a distance and condemns all these. In the second part of the poem, the sestet, the sea and the skylark described in octave and contrasted with man, man's deterioration seems to the poet evident in a tasteless seaside town. Hopkins began this poem in a joyous mood because he was aware of the refreshing beauty of nature. But when he observes the progress of human civilization, he is quite unhappy. Hopkins believes that man has forgotten the primal simplicity and purity. So students, I have explained you the entire poem, The Sea and the Skylark, composed by Hopkins. Thank you for listening to my presentation, and I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.